All right, so we are now slowly getting to our code implementation of the character RNN in PyTorch. And like I mentioned at the end of the previous video, we will split this into two parts. So this video will be on some conceptual aspects about the implementation, some, I would say, things that help us understanding the implementation, and then the next video will be the actual code example. So there's one thing I wanted to talk about, that's the Lstm class. We have used that before when we implemented the RNN for classification, but yeah, there was a question also on Piazza, and I made this ugly drawing trying to better explain the inputs and outputs, and I realized this is like one of the really obscure things in PyTorch. It's not so obvious what's going on there, because yeah, there are lots of inputs and outputs to the Lstm, and I wanted to explain this again for everyone. And spoiler, there's also an Lstm cell class that I also wanted to explain, especially the difference between the Lstm cell and the Lstm class in PyTorch. But yeah, one thing at a time. So we used this Lstm class before when we implemented the RNN for classification, and yeah, there are lots of things going on with that one. So here, just looking at the example, they initialize the Lstm. So there are three values. If we look up the values here in the usage, it's the input size, the number of expected features, essentially the hidden size, and the number of layers. So usually, not usually, but previously we used only one hidden layer, but we can also, of course, use multiple hidden layers. I will have a visualization showing you how that looks like in the next slide. But yeah, focusing on that, so we have, let's say, initialized our Lstm, and then here it's getting used, and it receives two inputs, so the input, and then the second input is this tuple here consisting of H0 and C0. So what are H0 and C0? These are our initial hidden state and cell state here. So here they use random numbers for everything, but usually we initialize the initial states with zeros. But here it doesn't really matter. Here they just want to try illustrating how inputs might look like from the dimension perspective. So what they essentially look like, what dimensions we need. In any case, so there are these inputs, and also as output, there's an output here and also a tuple with or called HN and CN here, where this is the hidden state of the last time step and the cell state after the last time step. So I had this relatively ugly drawing in Piazza. I actually searched on the internet a little bit to find a better visualization, and I found the following here on Stack Overflow, which illustrates this nicely, what everything here is. So the input here, which goes into the RNN, you can really think of it as your data input. Whereas this whole, so maybe I should use a different color, this whole thing should represent your Lstm, where here this is the depth, the number of layers. So this would be layer 1, layer 2, and layer 3. So previously in the code examples we only used one layer, but of course we can have multiple layers. It's just, you can see that it's just one layer on top of each other, right? So previously we only had, in the actual code example, in the lecture, we only had this one hidden layer, but we also talked about that we can have an arbitrary number of hidden layers, similar to how we can have an arbitrary number of layers in a convolutional network or in multilayer perceptron. Okay, so this is our input here at the bottom, right? And now H0 and C0, let me also use a different color, maybe yellow. So these are here our initial states that go into the Lstm. So here the 2 is for the number of layers. Okay, and then the output from the RNN, this is also for each time step. So there's one output for each time step, similar to how there's one input for each time step. In addition to that, it also returns here the hidden state and cell state for the last time step. So technically what we could do is we could have, let's say, another RNN call, say on some input sequence 2, together, so like we had it here, together with now here these HN and CN if we wanted to, for example, if we want to reuse that part, for example. All right, so, but this, yeah, this is conceptually what we get out. So this and this, these are our outputs, and this is our input here. Now the Lstm cell class is, it's kind of like part of the Lstm. It's a smaller unit. Like Lstm cell is only a small unit, and we can actually use both, either the Lstm or the Lstm cell for implementing the character RNN. And I have used both, and I will also provide you with code examples for both. But to be honest, I think using the Lstm cell class is a little bit more natural, because the way we compute the labels, it's a little bit more easy to do that, and also for generating data. So the Lstm cell, how it works is that it is just representing one small unit of what you've seen before. So the Lstm cell is naturally only one layer. Instead of setting the number of layers, we would have to stack them on top of each other. And using the figure that I showed you before here in the red box, this is essentially what represents the Lstm cell. So it only receives one character as the input. Then for the one layer, the hidden, the initial hidden and cell state, and it only outputs one output here, and then the hidden and cell state for the next state. So why that is more useful is in a way for computing the loss, essentially, that you can get one thing at a time, essentially, instead of running the whole thing. And if we would use the Lstm class, we would have to provide one character at a time as input, and it's kind of wasteful doing that. So handling-wise, I find the Lstm cell a little bit more easy to use for this purpose, but of course, you can use both. You can also, for the character RNN, for example, run this character RNN here with only one input, here multiple layers. You can also run it like that by only having an input of one input. But if we want to do this in the first place, we can also just use the Lstm cell and use that one. It's this smaller unit here, essentially. If we would only use one layer, we would then use this output here, put it to a fully connected layer to get the class label predictions, and then compute the loss, and then go on to the next character and so forth. And here we are going to do that in the code example in the next video. So one more thing, we are talking here about the many-to-many where we have, or we want to create text, so predicting the next word. If you are interested in another type of many-to-many architecture, for instance, language translation, I found they have actually a great tutorial on the PyTorch website. So we are not going to talk about language translation, because yeah, there is already a great tutorial, and it would be kind of boring for me just to reproduce this tutorial. So maybe if you're interested, you can just check it out and work through it step by step. So in the next video, we will focus on the character level RNN generating new text, and we will be using this Lstm cell class.